Annie Njoroge. Welcome to I Am with Annie. Today is the 29th day of August 2017, the last Monday of the month. We are 4 months away to the end of the year 2017. Today I'll be speaking on a topic that will have many thinking about in the last month of the year. And today we're going to be speaking about why some prayers end unanswered. You know, we begin reflecting on what we have been praying for towards the end of the year, because we're beginning a new year and we think that when we come into a new year, you know, we have new resolutions, we have new prayers. But in the middle of the year, some things, you know, we pray for at the beginning or the end of the year, and in the beginning of the year, you look back and you have not achieved, or what you prayed for has not come to pass. So the question that came to me was, why is it that when I pray for people, their prayers are answered, but when I pray for myself, my prayers are never answered? Obviously, we will only look at what Jesus taught us in the Bible in terms of prayer. So, and you know, there are many reasons why prayers are never answered, but we only focus on one today, or a few that come as we go. So, you know, when you pray for people, your intention is usually the best. Your motive for them is the best. Maybe you're praying for someone to get a job. You're actually very sincere that you want them to succeed in getting that job. When you're praying for someone who is sick, you actually want to see them well. So you really mean well. Your motive is good towards this. And when you pray, you mean it and you actually believe. So you know, the Bible says that when you pray, believe, and then it will come to pass. And because you have faith, then what you pray for comes to pass. But when you pray for yourself, you find your prayers just not going anywhere. You keep praying the same thing over and over again. And when you look back, you find that it's been months, it's been a whole year, God has not answered my prayer. And you can start even questioning your salvation, or questioning God's word, wondering, why is it that the scriptures say this, but when I pray, I'm not getting any results? We will look at the scripture in the book of Matthew. It is one of the subjects that Jesus covered on the Mount. So we will look at Matthew chapter 6 from verses 5. And this is what the Bible says. I hope you brought your pen and your paper. As we always say, that when you come to watch I Am with Annie, come with a pen and a paper so that we study the Word of God together. And if you have any questions, or if I have said something that you do not understand, or you disagree with what I said, or you have something to add on, you know, you can socialize on our social media. We have many who are waiting to study this Word. So share what you know, bring up questions, and I believe that we are all learning, and we will get somewhere at the end of the day. All right, so Matthew chapter 6, verse 5, and this is what the Bible says. And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by others. But truly, I tell you, they have their reward in full. Listen to what Jesus said. We're taking this step by step. They love to stand in the synagogues. So they're standing there in the synagogues, or on the street corners, you know, where there are passers-by, there are people selling and buying, the people just idling around, and that is where they will stand, on the street corners. But Jesus says, they're doing this because they want to be seen by others. Then he goes on to say that they have received their reward. This is my point. They have received their reward. So if you are praying, telling God that I need this, I need a new phone, I need something, and you're there praying in public, speaking in public, you know, so that you're seen by others. When I begin speaking, I said that when you pray for someone, your motive is for them to get well. Your motive is for them, for their prayer to be answered. But when you pray for yourself, what is your motive? Are you praying to get a new phone so that you can be better than somebody else, or so that you can be seen by someone? So this is what Jesus is saying. If that is the intention of your prayer, then you have already received your reward, because your reward is for them to be seen. And let me tell you something. God will never do anything that does not bring glory to his name. So if God answering your prayer is only bringing glory to you, then count that answer as dead. You are never going to receive that answer. But if you want to receive your answer because you want God to be glorified, then you will receive that. Then this is what Jesus said. But when you pray, go into your inner room. You know, go into your inner room. In my view, I don't think he really means that go into your closet, close the door, as literally as it says. This is entirely, in my own view, it is entirely covered by intentions. Then go into your inner room. You know, speak in your inner room. Speak from your heart, from deep within your heart. Then the Father, then close your door. You know, this is your secret. This is what you want, God. Oh, Lord, I need this. But it does not mean that you cannot bring your prayer request up maybe in church and say, God, this is what I need. It does not mean that. But if your intentions are naked, if your intentions are out there, if your intentions are displayed as, you know, being that you want to be better, to be seen as better than others, then you have received your reward and you're not going to receive anything from God because you have already received. Then he said this, then close the door and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. So God can see your intentions from deep within your heart. And because he can see your intentions, he can see that you are not praying because you want your prayers to be answered so that people can see that you're actually a prayerful person. Then, you know, you have been rewarded if that is your intention. Then he said, and when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. He actually knows what you need even before you ask him. The Bible says that he searches deep within the heart of man. He searches deep. He can see even before you think about something. He already knows that you will think about it. He already knows. And if you walk in the Spirit, if you are a son of God, the Bible says that he gives you the desires of your heart. In my understanding, I believe that what the Bible means is that he gives you what to desire. He gives you the desire of your heart. So he will give you what you desire. And if he has given you what to desire, then he will give you the heart to pray for it. And when you pray for it, you will not pray for it so that others can see that you're better than them. Alright? So you're not doing this to be seen by men. You pray in your heart. Your intentions are pure, entirely for God's glory. But when you see that what you are doing, even in giving, not only in prayers, because he, I think it was at the beginning, yeah, the verse that begins, it says, be careful not to do your acts of righteousness in front of others, to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven. So clearly, this is how he begins. He says, yes, you're righteous. You have been sanctified. You have been purified. But your righteousness should not be seen by men. Because after he died and resurrected, our righteousness is not from the works that we do. It is actually from what Jesus did at the cross. But the Pharisees and those people in those days, they used to do things so that they are seen by men. So that men can praise them. So that men can say, oh, this person is actually really good. This person is better than me. This person is better than you. And that will make you feel, you know, inferior. But this is not the intention that God has for us. He wants us to make them feel loved and make them feel that God really cares for them. And this is where I'm heading. And he says that, you know, meaningless repetition. You keep repeating the same thing. You keep saying the same thing. You know, sometimes you will annoy people because you keep saying something over and over again, making them feel that, you know, when I receive this, I'll be better than you. You know, God hears my prayer, so I'll be better than you. You make people feel inferior. That is not the intention of God for us when we pray. Or when people look at us, he wants us to be seen as representing him. And he is not proud, he is humble. So we need to represent him. And we need to present ourselves to others as humble in Jesus' name. So in the ninth verse, he says, this is then how you should pray. I love the Lord's Prayer. But it is not really the Lord's Prayer because He is not the one who prayed this prayer. He taught us how to pray this prayer, so it is actually our prayer or the disciples' prayer. So He said, when you pray, say this, Our Father in heaven. So when you're praying, you're not saying I, you're saying our Father. You're not praying for yourself. I want this, I want that. You pray, we want this, we want that, we need this. And so He said, Our Father. You know when you say Father, you acknowledge God. You acknowledge His supremacy. You acknowledge that He is your God. You acknowledge that He is your Father. In heaven, you know, hallowed be your name. You glorify His name. The name Father, you know, you glorify it. You glorify the name of God. You exalt the name of God because He is your Father and He is your God. And once you exalt Him, once you glorify Him, then that means that you have submitted under the authority of the Holy Spirit. Because if you do not submit yourself under the authority of the Holy Spirit, then you are not aware of the schemes of the enemy. Because the schemes of the enemy are pride. He brings pride in our hearts. And once you have pride, when you pray proud prayers. You pray so that people can see how you know how to pray. Meaningless repetition. You keep saying the same thing over and over again so that people can see that, see, this is all I am. This is all I am about. But this is not the intention of God. So, when you pray, you're not praying to impress. You're praying to exalt. That's how you begin. You're not praying to impress. You're praying to exalt. Because if you impress, you have already impressed. So what's there for God? There's nothing there for God. You have already received your reward. And He said this, Your kingdom come. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. You glorify the name of God. You exalt the name of God. You bring Him to closer visibility as the Father. You know the name Father is so relatable to all of us because there is nobody who was cloned. We were all born and we became because of the seed of a man. So because we are from the seed of God, because we are born of God, we are born of Him, we are children of God. And because we are children of God, then we bring him into closer visibility, that we see Him. You're closer to me because you're my daddy, you're my father. I can ask you for bread. I can ask you for water. I can pray to you because you are closer to me. So you say, Your kingdom come. Your kingdom that is exalted in heaven, let it come here on earth. And when you say that, the Bible says, Jesus said to them, Your will be done. Your will be done. And when I was studying about prayers, you know, I was so much fascinated when I read the prayer of Jesus just before He was taken, before He was arrested. The Bible says that He went to pray by Himself. And when He prayed, He said, Father, not my will but yours be done. He prayed from His heart. If it is your will, Father, then I will take this cup. I will drink it. But the cup was really bitter because He knew that He's going to be crucified high above on that cross. He knew that He's going to be humiliated. He knew that He was going to be beaten because of our infirmities. He knew that He was going to be humiliated in front of His mother. Those that called Him Lord, He knew that He who loved Him, the Bible calls Him the disciple that Jesus loved. He knew that these people are going to see their master up on a cross. And they will witness me die. They will witness me fall 3 times as I head to the cross. The cross will be heavy on me, Father, not my will, but yours be done. And so He tells us, when you pray, say your kingdom come. Say your will be done, not my will, but yours be done. I know the cross is heavy. I know that this cup is bitter, but not my will. My will is that really, that you know, I wear nice clothes. My will really is to live in a nice house. My will really is to have a good job. so that people can see that I am important. But if that is what you are about, that is what you're saying to yourself, you're really praying to God to give you something so that you can look important. You have already received your reward. And you don't expect to receive anything from God. You will not receive anything from God. That is what Jesus said, not my words, but his. The Bible says that you will not get any answer if your prayer is more towards the means of recognition, but not of God's. Then he says, I will read again verse 10. We're still in Matthew chapter 6, if you're just joining us. Verses 10 says, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth, even as it is in heaven. Your will be done on earth, even as it is in heaven. Then he says, verse 11, give us today our daily bread. Today, our daily bread. Jesus also taught us and said, do not worry of what you will eat, what you will drink, what you will wear. Because your Father in heaven, he loves you. If you being so wicked, you cannot give your children stone when they ask you for bread. What about your Father who is in heaven? Will he not give you so much more, even the Holy Spirit? He knows you. But if your prayers or what you're asking for God, or what you actually do, your actions, your works, it's like you're practicing righteousness before people so they can see that you're important. I feel like speaking something else. You know, when sometimes God will say something to you and you speak it to people, maybe a word of prophecy. Jonah knew that God is merciful and faithful. So when God sent him, he told him, and no, later now, later when all this happened, he said, did I not tell you that you're a faithful and a merciful God? Because he knew in the beginning, if I go and tell Nineveh or the Ninevites that they will perish, they will repent and pray. And if they repent and pray, then I will not look good. Because what I said in the beginning has not come to pass. Are you saying what you're saying so that you can look good? Are you prophesying so that that which you have said will come to pass so that you look good in front of people? Or so that you're recognized as the true prophet? Is our God not merciful? Are we not only mouthpiece? Only to speak the will of God? Is it not our joy that when we speak, people come to repentance? This is the will of God, that when we prophesy, when we speak the word of God, that they come to repentance. I will not preach to you about hell. I will not tell you that there is a hell so that you can go to hell and confirm that really there is a hell. No, I want you to know there is hell and there is a heaven so that you will know, you will choose where you want to go. But it is my joy if you go to heaven. You don't need to confirm that the wages of sin is death. No, believe. Believe the word of God. Believe it. And we as preachers, we as teachers of the law, the Bible says we will be condemned. We will. By what we say. Remember what Jesus said to the Pharisees? You know the eight woes? Yeah. He condemned them in one of the harshest teachings Jesus gave. He said, woe to you, Pharisees, teachers of the law. You understand the law very well. You know it. But what do you choose to do? Stand on the way. You stand at the door. The ones that are out, you don't want to let them come in. The ones that you're teaching, you don't want them to come into understanding. You're just standing there. The will of the Father is that his kingdom comes here on earth. And it is his will for us to pray for the kingdom of God to come. And he also says, give us our daily bread. Forgive our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. If you want the Father to forgive you, and you do not forgive others, then how do you expect to be forgiven and you don't forgive others? I was not intending to speak on the entire prayer. I just want to go back into how to pray and why some prayers are not answered. And actually, the Lord's Prayer can show us openly that when you pray and your intentions are only that you receive that answer so that you look important before people, so that people recognize you as a true prophet, so that people can see that surely this one is a giver. You've been blessed because you've been giving. In this sermon, when you read the entire book, check out Matthew 7:7. The Bible says, "Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks, receive. Those who seek, find. And those who knock, the door will be opened." Which of you, if your son asks for bread, will you give a stone? Or if you ask for a fish, will you give him a snake? Will you really? You will give them what they ask. But again, the Bible also says, you have not because you ask not. And when you ask amiss. Verses 12. So in everything, do to others what you would want them to do for you. For this sums up the law and the prophets. Do unto others. You cannot be mistreating other people and you go before God expecting to receive a blessing. These are the hindrances to our own prayers. This is what is hindering you from hearing what God, from receiving, sorry, what God has kept for you. You know what? God has already released your blessing. Blessed are the pure in heart. Blessed, 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 blessed. You're blessed. Actually, just having Jesus himself is a blessing. That is already a blessing in itself because you have He who is the way, the truth, and the life. He is the way to everything that you need. He gives life to everything that is dead. So you don't need anything more if you have Jesus. He is everything. He is our daily bread. He is everything. But if there is more that you need, then you ask. But you have bad intentions. You know what you have actually done? You have given the devil the authority to hold it. Not the devil knows the word of God. He does. He knows the word of God. He knows the law. I mean the law, the laws of God, of the word of God. He knows, he understands it completely. And you know what else the devil is? He is the accuser of brethren. In the book of Revelation, the Bible says he accused believers day and night. Don't think that you will go around presenting yourself righteous to people, then you go before God and pray for something and expect to receive. If you want to receive only for your own righteousness or for your own sake, but you forget that the glory is supposed to go back to God. The motive and the intentions of our prayer need to be for our Father. And we need to pray corporate prayers. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Even if you have that one need, you're praying, you need school fees for your child. You're not the only one in this world who needs school fees. There are other people as well. Why not say, our Father who is in heaven? Myself and each parent and all the other parents who are in need of school fees. How about that? It is not I. You remember what the book says? The book of Ezekiel? How the devil fell? The Bible says that he said, I will be like the Most High. I will exalt myself. It was about Him. So if everything that you're praying for has so many eyes in it, my dear, you have already received your reward. Because it shows that clearly you're selfish. And you only want that which benefits you and not others. I'm not here to rebuke you, sorry, because I have my own eyes. Sometimes I pray and I remember like, oh my God, I'm being selfish here. And I will not receive anything. I will not receive my reward from God. So today, my brethren, my dear brothers and sisters, do not do good works simply to be seen by men. In the book of Matthew chapter 5, verse 16, I will read a verse that people often think that contradicts the text that we are reading today. So we'll go to 5:16. The Bible says, okay, I'll begin at 14. So it's Matthew 5:14. You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. So when people look at this, you know, I might have been through that stage as well in my early years. But you know, as you continue in Christ, as you continue studying the Bible, you grow. You stop taking milk and you start taking hard stuff. So here, he says that you cannot light a lamp and put it under the bed. You have to put it, let it be seen. Because you are the light of the world. That is what he's telling us. You are the light of the world. It needs to be seen. But do you have your own light? Do you? Do you have your own light? Do you have your own righteousness? Did you die on the cross? You don't have your own righteousness. Listen again. Listen carefully. Carefully. You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp. A lamp does not light itself. It is lit. Somebody has lit that fire. And that somebody is not you. What am I trying to say? I'm trying to tell you that your own righteousness is not what Jesus is talking about here. He's not saying, now just because you have become something, put yourself up there. No, 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 that's not what he says. He's not saying that. You're given out to display the works of the cross. You're put out there to display the light of the world, who is Jesus. In the book of John, I will go there quickly. I love the book of John. Let's see. The book of John, where is the book of John? Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Wow, okay. Chapter 1. The book of John, chapter 1, verses 9. But I'll begin at 6. This is what the Bible says. I hope you're still with me. I'm not losing you. If I am, please put some comments down there. And next time I'll try to please. I just get super excited when I'm talking about the word of God. I find myself going all the way. I forget that I'm supposed to be teaching. Oh well. John chapter 1, verses 6. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness. John was a witness to testify concerning that light. You hear? He came to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. The light in you is supposed to be glorifying God, that through you they can see him. Not that through him they can see you, not the other way around. It is that through you, you are the works of his hands. You are a display of the work of God. You are a display, but you are not the real thing. It is through you. It is through you. He says, he came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. We are the lights of the world. We are the lamps. The light shines within us. The lamp itself is not light. The light is inside the lamp. Hallelujah. And the Bible says, the true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. And because he came into the world, we saw him. He was in the world, and through the world was made through him, and the Bible goes on. But he also says that we saw him, the glory of the one begotten Son. So my brothers and my sisters, in everything you do, do nothing for your own gain. Do nothing for your own glory, because that's just about it. You will not receive anything more from the Father. But let your prayers, that everything that you do, your righteousness, do not display it, because you're not righteous by your own works. It is by the works of the cross. So this is actually what we are supposed to display, the works of the cross. I'm just about to close. Yes, time is so limited. I'm going to pray for you real quick. And I believe that God will give us another chance. Next Monday, come, let us share the word of God. If you want me to continue on this topic, I feel like there's so much to speak about, tell me. Otherwise, there's another topic lined up for you. This is a paid program. If you would like to support me, to extend, maybe go for a whole hour, let's do it. Say something. Contact MTN, contact me, and let's do this. Let's preach. Let's preach the gospel. I'm going to pray for you. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for my viewer this night. Bless them. If there is anyone, my Father, who is proud, who has a proud heart, when they come before you, Father God, I pray, Jehovah God, that you reveal to them, open the eyes of their hearts, that they may see, Jehovah God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, I bless you. Any prayers, my God, that might have been hindered by ill intentions, Father, I pray that you open and release the blessings, because we have learned, we have heard your word. Deliver us from our own selves in the name of Jesus. God bless you. God keep you. My name is Annie Njoroge. I love you so much. Interact with me on social media, and I believe that there is so much more that God has in store for us. So see you again next Monday. Bye-bye.